Hey, screenwriters, you're tuned in to the Write On podcast from Final Draft. I'm Shani Edwards. Before I chat with John Orloff, creator and writer of Masters of the Air, a quick word about Final Draft, the industry standard screenwriting software. The newest version, Final Draft 13, is now available with new features like writing stats, midnight mode, typewriter view, and more. Plus more customization for your navigator and outline editor. Final Draft 13 gives you more tools, more productivity, and more progress. I just upgraded from 11 to 13 and I am loving the new features. You can visit finaldraft.com to learn more. Well, let's get to writer John Orloff and his work on the World War II epic TV show Masters of the Air on Apple TV Plus, starring Austin Butler and Callum Turner. John talks about what he learned from working with executive producer Tom Hanks, writing primarily from theme, and finding a central character to connect the episodes through the sprawling cast of airmen, many of whom, unfortunately, meet their ultimate fate while in the air fighting fascism. Let's start the show. Well, hello, John Orloff. Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, believe me, it's my pleasure. We're here to talk about Masters of the Air, and it is such a fabulous, what did you call it? Not a TV show.
A 9-part series event.
I love it. So before we get into the nitty-gritty of writing the 9-part series event, maybe you could tell me a little bit about your background, how you got into writing, how did you break through, and eventually you got to Band of Brothers.
Okay, that's actually pretty easy because band is part of the story.
Great.
I'm fourth generation Hollywood.
Okay.
So my great-grandparents were in the business, my grandparents were in the business, my parents were in the business, my brother's in the business, my uncles are in the business, da, 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 da. I was sort of stuck wanting to be in the business, went to UCLA, wanted to be a director, got into production, realized very quickly I don't want to be a director, and ended up sort of writing a spec about the Shakespeare authorship question that somehow got to Playtone right after Tom Hanks and Gary Getzman started their company. So I got in early days. They read my Shakespeare script.
Anonymous, which I've seen.
It eventually became anonymous. Loved it, but didn't want to make it. Fine. But I ended up having a general meeting with Tom. Actually, I don't even think it was a general. I think it was specifically about a movie that he wanted to find a writer for, a movie that didn't end up getting made. And anytime I was in this meeting with Tom, I'd say, oh, I heard about you guys making this show called Band of Brothers. I'm really into World War II. If you need an extra writer, I would just love to do it. And at first, Tom was like, no. We're just going to have one writer guy write it, Eric Jenderson, who wrote the Bible. He's great, blah, blah, blah. Then I guess they got the green light. And suddenly they needed 10 episodes written. And I'm in a meeting with Tom and he just sort of says, hey, you still interested in working on Band of Brothers? And I'm like, yeah. And he literally says to me, you want to write the D-Day episode? And I go, okay. Now, it's only 2 years after Saving Private Ryan, because this is like 99, 2000. And so Saving Private Ryan is like fresh in everybody's memories. And it's the D-Day episode. Now, the opening 20 minutes of Saving Private Ryan are absolute genius D-Day.
Right? Absolutely. Yeah.
So, okay. Now, so my first paying writing job is for Tom Hanks and Steven Spielberg writing the D-Day episode of Band of Brothers.
So this happened all because you wrote a Shakespeare authorship.
I wrote a 16th century Elizabethan melodrama in the late 90s when the town was aching for more 16th century Elizabethan melodramas. I say that sarcastically.
Right. No, of course.
So yeah. So, and after I wrote episode 2, I went in for my notes with Tom. They were shockingly minor.
Wow.
That never happened in the rest of my life, other than the other Band of Brothers script. And he says, that was great. You want to write another one? I go, okay. How about the concentration camp episode?
Okay.
So now you're asking me to now do the Schindler's List thing. Okay. Oh. So yeah, those are my two first jobs in Hollywood.
So what did you have to learn or teach yourself when you hit the ground running with two of the biggest incidences of war in, you know, our history.
It was very intimidating. I'm not going to lie, particularly the concentration camp episode. That was really, really, really difficult to write. I think I froze for a good month after I was asked to write it. I felt the obligation, particularly for that episode, because we all felt a huge obligation to Dick Winters and the rest of Easy Company, because we had come to know them as people, like literally know them. I'd spent time with them physically. So we already knew we owed them something. I owe myself an opportunity to deliver my script. And by deliver, I mean deliver a shooting script that they can make to Steven Spielberg and Tom Hanks, two of the, you know, we all know who they are. And I owe the world a story about concentration camps that is good and believable and moving. And so it was really, really kind of hard, intimidating.
Well, you said you froze, and honestly, I've had that same experience. But what got you through it? Like, what made you put your butt in the chair and actually start pounding it out?
Just, I guess, fear, like most, you know, fear of failure, fear of not delivering, fear of something is better than nothing. Mm-hmm. I guess I had a little bit of, well, if they believe I can do it, then maybe I really can.
Right.
You know, but it definitely... it was definitely intimidating every single day because I was unproduced, mm-hmm. right? It's my first job. I'm unproduced. I have, you know, imposter complex, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. all that stuff, just like anybody else would, you know, mm-hmm. somehow I got through it, you know?
Wow. Well, Band of Brothers ended up being a huge success, right?
Yeah. Really on DVD though, not when it first came out, because it premiered, the first two episodes premiered September 9th, 2011.
Oh my God.
2001, sorry.
2001, yeah.
So it was 2 days before 9/11. Uh-huh. And once 9/11 hit, nobody wanted to watch Band of Brothers. So a year later, 2 years later, it became a hit on DVD.
Wow. I had forgotten about the timing of that show. Yeah. Okay. Wow. That's some really interesting timing.
We had a huge Sunday night for the first two episodes. And then a week later, 20% of that audience watched it.
Wow. All right. So what did you do after Band of Brothers?
Well, I don't remember. I mean, I wrote things that didn't get made.
Sure.
Some for Playtone and Tom, some for other people. But my first next thing was a film for Plan B, their very first film, actually, called A Mighty Heart.
Oh, yeah.
Which was directed by Michael Winterbottom in 2007. Angelina Jolie starring as Marion Pearl, another real life story. Really dark. I seem to be attracted to dark stories where real people die.
Yes. Wow. That's so fascinating. But that's about as dramatic as you can get, right?
Yeah. I guess. I was really happy to do the Owl movie with Zack Snyder a few years later, an animated movie where it's all about talking owls.
Oh, I bet that was a bit of levity for your career,
yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about Masters of the Air. Were you the first choice? And I know you developed it. So did you come to Tom Hanks and Steven Spielberg with this story?
No, Steven, my understanding is Steven read the book Masters of the Air first. And after he read it, he called up Tom and said, I think we found the next one. This book is amazing. And these three guys in particular, Gail Clevin, John Egan, and Robert Rosenthal, I think should be a series. So I got a phone call from Tom basically saying, hey, are you interested? We're going to do another one. And I read the book. And indeed, it is an amazing story. And particularly Buck and Bucky's journey is really exceptional. Yeah. So then very quickly became a very difficult job, though, because as once I said yes, and I started to figure out what is the show going to be, I was sort of faced with the issue that Don Miller's really great book is not entirely about the 100th Bomber Group, like Band of Brothers is entirely about Easy Company. The Masters of the Air is a 600-700 page book about the entire air war against Nazi Germany. And part of it is about Buck and Bucky and rosy, but not a lot. It's just a couple of key events to sort of show the reader what a bomber unit did in this larger book. My first job was a full year of just figuring out what the heck these guys did for 18 months, because we can't make it up, you know? So I wrote a Bible that is quite extensive, 250 pages,
wow,
30 sources, 550 footnotes. It was a pretty serious document, but I knew that's what we had to do, because I can't tell you what the series is without knowing what the guys really did, right? That's how we do it, right?
Right.
But there's no book about the 100th Bomber Group like there was about Easy Company. Mm-hmm. So I kind of had to write a book about these four guys. One of the first things the other big thing I did was Harry Crosby's a little bit mentioned in Don's book, but not very much. And Harry Crosby, as soon as I read Harry Crosby's book in doing my research, he wrote a memoir. I realized, well, this guy, A, is not a pilot, which is interesting because our other three main characters are pilots. And two, he's the only guy from the original 36 airplanes that arrived with the 100th in England in June of 1943. He's the only guy that is still at the base in May 1945, VE Day. Everybody else is either shot down, killed, or fulfills their mission and goes home. So that was kind of a narrative problem for me, right?
Of course, because a big one.
A big one. Yeah. So luckily, Crosby is there the whole war and could be the glue that connects these characters that, like as you saw in episode 4, which as we're speaking, just aired this last week, Robert Rosenthal, who will become our next fourth lead, he's our fourth main character.
Yes.
But he doesn't, he's a replacement pilot. In real life, he doesn't show up in real life until the end of August, beginning of September, when Buck and Bucky have already been there 4 months, right? So, and there's very little overlap because, as you saw in episode 4, Bucky's shot down. Buck is shot down. Mm-hmm. So Rosie and Buck barely meet each other, you know, but Crosby's there the whole time, you know, and he ends up becoming one of Rosie's best friends in real life, you know. So Crosby became like the glue. So anyway, so that was the Bible. So it took me a year to write the Bible. You know, I was basically a historian for a year, but it was totally fun. It was so much fun.
So I love that you took Crosby and made him the narrator, and he's the eyes and the ears of this whole story. And like you said, the glue, and we get to see from his perspective, like you said, because he's on the base the whole time. Yeah, it would be a very different show without that perspective, because...
Yeah. Have you seen the whole show?
I finished episode 9 last night.
And, oh, great.
I had to finish it.
I appreciate it. That's kind of my favorite episode, or at least one of.
Oh,
9.
Yeah. Yeah, it's wonderful.
It's a movie. Almost.
It
I mean,
absolutely.
The scale of it is kind of crazy, isn't it? Episode 9?
Well, I mean, the scale of the whole show, you know, you're in England, you're in Europe, you're in Africa.
Yeah.
I mean, you're up in the air, you're down on the ground. It's
you're in Germany, you're in Poland,
London.
You're in. Yeah. Yeah. But that's what the air war was. That was so baked into the idea. I mean, when we talked about the show in early days, Tom and me, we just always talked about scale. The air war was about scale. You know, it is the polar opposite of Band of Brothers, which is about a tight-knit unit getting through the war. This is not about a tight-knit unit getting through the war. It's about attrition. It's about best friends trying to survive the next 12 hours in an airplane, or 6 hours in an airplane. And it's a different thing. And what the show is about is, well, it's about a lot of things, but one of the things that we wanted to convey in the show was the scale of the effort that was required to end fascism. When we start the show, you'll see on their first mission, I think, you know, you might see 25 planes, you know, but by the final mission, there's 1,000 airplanes in the air. You know, that's what we did. You know, we built 12,000 B-17s and 18,000 B-24s in a couple of years. We went from 200 bombers to 20,000 bombers, you know, and that's part of the story.
Yeah, it's incredible. And I kept watching as these very young men, I mean, basically teenagers, they're so vulnerable. You don't think how vulnerable they are up in the air, not just getting shot at, but, you know, there's the one guy and he gets stuck in the bubble, and then they have to parachute out, and then they have to survive, you know, Nazis on the ground.
And it's pretty amazing. I mean, it is really amazing. And you didn't even bring up the cold in the air. It's negative 40 degrees. Up there. It's unpressurized, unheated. It is hell before you have anybody shooting guns at you or flak at you. You know, yeah, we put these kids in real serious harm's way.
Absolutely. Well, I want to ask you about putting the characters down on the page. A lot of the heart of the story is with Buck and Bucky, mm-hmm. Austin Butler and Callum Turner, who are just two terrific young actors.
Yeah. And isn't their chemistry amazing?
Yes.
I mean, I just think they are so great together in that, again, that ninth episode, mm-hmm. you know, when it's just, yeah, I'm just so thrilled by their performances.
Yes. Well, their chemistry is fantastic. But when you're writing, you don't know who what actors are going to play.
So
you have to, A, create the potential for that chemistry on the page. But also you have to define these two men, young men. They have to be different. They have to mm-hmm. feel different. How did you differentiate them on the page and make us like them at the same time?
Well, again, I'm always going to come back to this is who these guys were, you know? And so I did my research. I did, you know, my due diligence, and these guys did love each other. They were this inseparable pair, and, you know, they had their differences in personalities, and you just capture that, you know? I mean, it's just part of the gig. I don't know how to be more, you do it in dialogue. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, you do it in the way any screenwriter does it, right? You just, once you know what that relationship is, you write that relationship, right? And so right. That's what I did, you know?
I love the scenes that were up in the air, and that to me seemed like the general structure of the episodes, and you can mm-hmm. tell me if I'm incorrect, but it's all about getting those boys up in the air. And then mm-hmm. as the series progresses, the stakes seem to get higher and higher as we're closing into D-Day and all of those things. And then we end up with our pilots on the ground. But tell me about the episodes where you had to get them up in the air and really show us how difficult it was to fly in the war.
One of the great things about working with, well, there's so many things that are great about working with Tom Hanks, but he really trusts his actors, you know, for obvious reasons. He assumed from the moment we were working on the show that we would hire talented actors. Tom and Steven have a knack for that. And one of the things he said to me is, we're going to reveal character through procedure.
Ooh, what does that mean?
That means pushing buttons. It means how you get a plane ready to go, how you do all that stuff. I will take you back to Apollo 13.
Oh, great movie.
That is about three guys in a room the size of a bathtub, just pushing buttons. And yet we know and care about them. And so, you know, the procedures of getting an airplane in the air was an opportunity to remind the audience that, okay, there's no magic buttons to push in 1943 to get an airplane in the air. There's not even motors on the wing flaps. It's all pulleys and ropes. You know, it is a thing just to get these planes airborne. That is a challenge already. And let's capture that. And let's explain that to the audience early on in the first episode or two. And then they'll know that that happens every time, you know? And even landing a plane, that's what the Greenland scene in the opening is. It's about, yeah, these things are hard to fly. You know, it's dangerous anytime you go up in one of these planes. You know, but can we reveal character at the same time, or use it as a tool to cut in between different cockpits and introduce the three cockpits we're going to be following on the first mission to Bremen. So during that procedure, we cut to the three different cockpits we're going to follow through the show or through that fight sequence. So the procedure stuff, the getting ready for the mission, as you said, is doing multiple things for us. I mean, as a screenwriter, for me, any beat in a screenplay should be doing several things at once or it should be thrown out. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's just conveying to the audience one idea or one theme or one emotion, then you're wasting time.
I love this idea of revealing character through procedure because you really do get to see who dots their I's and crosses their T's.
And exactly.
Who says, it'll happen. We'll make it happen in the air. You know, I'm probably more the latter. I'm just like, it'll come together. So maybe he'll put me in the cockpit of a plane.
But you need really good filmmakers, directors, DPs, and actors, you know, who are in on that, okay, it's not just about flicking a switch. There's something else going on here and you need to capture it.
I want to ask you about probably one of my favorite scenes in the series is when Bucky goes to London on just to take a break and he meets the Polish woman and they spend the night together. And it's so sweet and so sad at the same time. Mm. And they're in the room and they're watching the bombs go off. And he says something like, I've never been on the other side of this kind of business.
Yeah, he's never been on the business end of a bomb.
Yes. And for me, it really does change the perspective of what's going on in that war. Maybe you could talk about that scene because then she says a few things too that I thought really chilled me to the bone.
We wanted to show the audience, you know, that these bombs are real. They have an effect on the people they land on. And later on in the series, you see that in Germany. But at this point in the show, we don't have an opportunity to do that. And we also wanted to show the audience that it wasn't a one-way street, that the Germans were bombing civilians. And in fact, they started bombing civilians in the Spanish Civil War. The Germans are the first people to aim specifically on civilians' bombs.
Really?
Yeah. They did it in the German Civil War, Guernica. You know, the village Guernica, when the Stukas come down. I think they did it once before that, even also in the German Civil War. And then they bombed Rotterdam at the outset of World War II. And then they bombed London. Then the British started bombing the Germans. And it was indiscriminate. Civilians could be, they were not doing, I don't want to get into a whole conversation about whether precision bombing was real or not. But certainly the British were not even trying to do bombing where they avoided civilians. They were just blind carpet bombing targets. And so we wanted to show the audience, you know, that this was a two-way street and it was devastating. There was a better scene of that. And since this is a screenwriting podcast, I'm going to tell you what it was.
Please.
We had him, we just couldn't do it in the budget. We had Egan go down to the subways. And the people were living in the subways. Mm-hmm. So you'd go in the subways and it looked like a dormitory because that was the safest place to be. So families would be in bunk beds down the inner tubes. And unfortunately, we just, as expensive as this show was, we still had to make, you know, monetary decisions. And so we couldn't do that. But it's the same idea what we did. You know, it's like these guys are suffering and people are dying and it's really bad. And then we see it in Germany later on, you know, in a couple of episodes as well. But yeah, we wanted to show. And then as you said, what does that emotionally do to our characters? It happens a couple of times. It happens in episode 4. No, yeah, the end of 4, right? No, the end of, I'm sorry, the end of 2.
Okay.
The end of 2, they're after the bike race, a village near them was bombed, and it really was. They were actually hit, that base was actually hit once or twice. We don't show it in the show, but they were bombed nearby, you know, more than a few times. And so we show it multiple times, you know, in different ways, what it feels like to be near a bombing event. We don't show an actual one on the ground as it's happening.
Mm-hmm. The series starts out very, I don't know if apolitical is the right word, but we don't really hear that much about what the Nazis are doing, what they stand for, fascism. It's really focused on just these kids in the plane. And as time goes on, you know, they start to see more and more of the consequences and the bombings, and they start to talk about, you know, fighting monsters and all of that stuff. And the tone of the show starts to get darker and darker. Was that on purpose, or could you, I mean, I guess you had to.
Yeah. I mean, so I see the first four episodes as sort of our first act.
Okay.
And that first act is about what I would call the first generation of bomber boys. And the first generation of bomber boys, like Clevin and Egan, joined up way before the war started. They joined up because they were enamored with flying. Mm-hmm. They joined the U.S. Army because they saw movies like Top Gun. I mean, there were movies in the late 30s about aviation and test pilots. There was this Spencer Tracy, Clark Gable movie, literally called Test Pilot, which is sort of the Top Gun of the 30s. And that's why they joined, right? Mm-hmm. They didn't join because they wanted to be in the army. They joined up because they wanted to fly airplanes. And that was the only way you could fly an airplane. So they have all these romantic notions of flying. They've got their white scarves. They really did. They have their hats cocked, their toothpicks in their mouth. This is going to be just a fun, romantic ride. We're going to kill them Nazis and go home, as Biddick says in episode one. Mm-hmm. Well, it turns out it wasn't quite that easy, and it's not that romantic. And, you know, as you said, as the show progresses, the romance absolutely disappears 100% by episode 5. And yes, that was all sort of, you know, one of the through lines of the show. And then to sort of your question talked about this too. So let me dip into it, which is, we start off very, very narrowly through the point of view of Buck and Bucky.
Yes.
You know, it starts with just the two of them in a restaurant, and it's from their point of view. And as I said, they didn't join up for political reasons, you know? And so we learn about the politics of fascism literally as Egan is learning about fascism in the most real way possible. And that opens up a lot of questions and information and dialogue and music, even in episode 6. Mm-hmm. There's a song, you know, and it's a very political song. And yeah, so it's all conscious.
My other question to you, and I personally, as a writer, I'm working on a war film as well. It takes
place. I'm sorry.
I think all screenwriters have one in us.
Yeah, definitely.
So this is mine, and it takes place about 100, maybe 70 years before this one, and there are no airplanes invented yet. But especially in these older wars, I guess in all wars, there's just so much death, there's so much destruction, there's so much loss.
So can I interrupt you? Because
yes, please.
It's a thing that I don't talk a lot about, and I don't think people can, unless you're a writer, maybe you can't even relate to this. But, you know, I spent 5 years. So after I spent a year writing the outline, I spent 5 years writing the first 7 episodes.
Wow. Okay.
Each episode was about 80 to 90 pages in the first draft. And one of the decisions I made really, really early on was, because there's a tremendous amount of information about these missions, because the Air Force, it went so badly. The Air Force was trying to figure out, why is it going so badly? So after each mission, the guys couldn't talk to anybody before they talked to their own intelligence officers, explaining to them everything they knew that happened on that mission. How many planes were hit? When they were hit? Were there parachutes? Where were the planes hit? They tried to track that to figure out, are the Germans attacking from the front? Does that mean we put more guns on the front? It was a constantly changing situation. But what that meant as a writer was, let's take episode one of this show. I knew exactly what planes went down. I know the formation of those planes because I can find it. So because of my work on Band of Brothers and sort of feeling the obligation to getting it right to honor those guys, I said, well, let's go all the way. So if a plane goes down in this show, that's a real plane. It's not the seventh plane to the left goes down. No, no, no. That's Hollenbeck's plane. Mm-hmm. I know it's Hollenbeck's plane, and I know where he was in the formation. Mm-hmm. So let's do it right. So every plane, almost every plane, I'm sure there are a couple that the directors made some choices, or it's a real plane going down. And if you see that plane going down with its engine number 3 on fire, that's probably because its engine number 3 was really on fire the last time it was seen. The corollary of that as a writer is I'm writing about people dying, real people dying, every single day I'm writing. And sometimes those deaths are really unpleasant, mm-hmm. you know, and it's in your head day after day after day. And the air war was brutal. And as you've seen in the show, it's just... Everybody dies or is shot down, or it was just horrible. So yeah, it takes an emotional toll on one as a writer, you know?
Yes, it does. It's hard to believe. It's hard to, in any war, it's hard to believe that it's tolerated and it keeps going until hopefully, you know, you achieve the end of fascism, or at least the end of the Nazis, or the end of the Russian army, or whatever war you're writing about.
Right.
How do you balance that on the page? Because you can't just write about people dying. You also have to write about, the Polish woman says in that one scene, something about the closer to death, the more you feel alive. Mm-hmm. So you have to, I guess, at some point, really...
Well, that's why they were all partiers. That's why they were sleeping around. Mm-hmm. That's why they were getting drunk every night. They all knew. It's not like these guys were idiots, right? It doesn't take anybody a long time to figure out you're probably going to die.
Right.
You know, the odds are you're going down. That became obvious to these guys pretty early on. And so, I mean, we're in October, right? The episode 4 and episode 5, when we lose most of our original cast members.
Yes.
You know, that's only October, the first week of October in 1943. It's only like 15 weeks since they showed up. Hey. Right. So 34 of the original 36 planes went down. So 36 planes shows up in June of 43. By October 9th of 43, 34 of those 36 planes are gone. And the guys knew it, right? After, you know, after a couple of months, they're like, oh, fuck, this isn't going to go well. And so they partied. There was a lot of sex, mm-hmm. you know, people are about to die and they want to have a good time. And we show it a little bit, you know, but it is that counterpoint of living life on the edge because it could be gone in a matter of minutes.
Absolutely. What advice do you have for anyone like me who's writing a war film? Obviously, I've done a lot of research, but you also, and there are memoirs, and you used a really powerful one.
Yeah.
But at some point, you have to make that leap from somebody's memoir to the page, put it in a structure, and make it tell a story that's going to be entertaining.
I always go back to theme. Always go back to theme. Why are you writing this story? You know, what is that final couple of minutes of the movie? What do you want the audience to feel? And so I kind of always build backward from that in some ways. You know, what are the last 2 minutes? And how do I make, in a, let's say, a movie, how do I make the 118 minutes preceding those 2 minutes build to those last 2 minutes? Mm-hmm. That's to me like a really good film. And anything that's not helping building to those last 2 minutes, throw it out. Thematically, you know, if a scene is structurally, if a scene isn't helping you tell your big idea, then it doesn't belong in the script. That's always sort of been my kind of guiding light, I guess. You know, I've always been just really thematically driven, not plot driven. Yeah, I mean, character driven. Yeah. I mean, obviously character and plot are enormously important, obviously, but as long as you feel confident in your theme or themes, you know, that's always what I'm working off of.
I love that, working towards the last 2 minutes. Would you mind just putting into a few sentences the theme of this? I mean, I can probably extrapolate it, but...
Of Masters or...
Yeah,
or,
sure.
Well, yeah. Masters is a little bit unwieldy thematically.
Okay.
You know...
It's really hard.
It is. But what I was always trying to do was basically say fascism is really, really bad. And if you don't nip it in the bud, bad things happen. And these are the bad things. It's not about a band of brothers, although that's one of the themes, you know, but it's different, you know, it's examining a larger battlefield and larger existential themes, I think. I think in some ways the whole show is about sacrifice, survival, trying to survive. But ultimately, it's about what it takes to defeat evil, because it doesn't just happen.
Do you think that's why this show and other shows about World War II are still being made?
Yes.
Right now?
Yeah, I think that the stakes were so clear. I mean, mm-hmm. obviously, there is moral dilemmas on both sides, and we can... You know, America was not perfect during the war. We can have those side conversations. But in the macro sense, it was a necessary war. And the other thing that's really fascinating about it that I think we forget because of the 85 years since, there's never been anything like it, which is it is a world war. It's really a world war. Everybody on planet Earth was affected in some way by this war. Didn't matter whether you were civilian or not. Didn't matter whether you lived in Arkansas or not. You were affected by this war. If you were a woman living in Arkansas, you didn't get butter, you didn't get fuel, you were making all sorts of sacrifices. Maybe you were working somewhere else, building bombers, working in a factory. Everybody was doing something. Then on top of it, you have these incredibly clear moral stakes. And then you can start exploring those moral stakes. I mean, you know, what's the really... I haven't seen it yet, the Auschwitz movie right now.
Oh, it's called, yeah.
but there it is. Like, here's another way.
Zone of Interest.
Thank you. Zone of Interest. I haven't seen it. I will. I can't wait to see it. But there's another. You think we've explored these concentration camps enough and discussed the moral grayness, well, not grayness, but the moral complexity of what these places yes. were like. Well, here's a brilliant filmmaker who's figured out another way to explore that stuff, mm-hmm. you know, and at a time where we're talking about concentration camps here, not mm-hmm. extermination camps, not, yeah. but by definition, a concentration camp is just a camp that is basically overcrowded. It is concentrated with too many people. Mm-hmm. That's what a concentration camp literally is. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've been building some of those ourselves. You know, there is a constant relevance, I think, with World War II.
Unfortunately, but
yeah.
you made a terrific event, 9-part series.
You can call it a TV show. I tease. I was teasing because it is weird to call it a mini series, you know, or yeah. a limited series. I always feel that's weird. And this one in particular, I don't know if you noticed, it's not quite as episodic as Band of Brothers.
Right.
You know, the episodes end, but more like a chapter ending, less like a dun, 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 or a cliffhanger, or, yeah, we have those too, you know, but often it just ends like a book chapter would end, you know?
Well, yeah, because you also have so many different characters and yeah. they're coming and going. Do you think that we'll see another Masters of the Air? Because there's plenty more stories to tell.
I don't. That is such a Stephen and Tom question, not
a
John.
Call him on the phone right now.
Because trust me, nobody wants to make John Orloff's, you know, World War II giant show. They want to make Tom and Stephen's, rightfully so. So it's really up to those guys. I mean, you know, I know that Tom is maybe working on another Greyhound, and you know, we'll see if that all comes to fruition, but. I think, you know, who knows? You never know. I don't know if I would do it again. This was really? 10 years of my life.
Gotcha. Wow.
I started working on it in 2013.
Yeah.
Or 2014, really. I said yes in 2013, started working on it in 2014, and it was really hard. It was really, really hard. There was nothing easy about it on any part of the process. So I'm certainly going to take a break. I mean, I took a break before. I didn't work on the Pacific. I specifically, they asked me, I was kind of still kind of all done with World War II. It is a really emotional process for me. My wife calls me the method writer. I get really emotional and invested, and I take it a little too seriously maybe when it's about real people. You know, I really. So this took a lot out of me, this show. So it's going to be a while before I come back to a something of this scale.
Well, thank you for giving us those 10 years and lending us your heart to tell this story. It's really important. Fascism is real still today.
And it's on the march.
I hope everybody will sit down and watch the show because it's got a story to tell about today, even.
Yeah, I think so too. Very much so.
John, thank you so much for chatting with me today.
It's so been my pleasure.
I could talk to you all day.
It's been my pleasure.
So if you get bored, call me back.
Well, I hope people will like what I had to say.
Absolutely. Well, you take care. And have your next project, let's chat again.
Excellent. Excellent. Okay. Thank you so much.
All right, John. Take care.
You too. Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Right On. Masters of the Air is currently streaming on Apple TV Plus. As always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. If you haven't already, subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on X at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Final Draft and Shaney Edwards. Editing is by Bombardier, Sean Bonnet, music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.